Hello and welcome to the latest episode of Virtual Thoughts. I think it's going to be episode 12 or 13, and I'm here with Atchison Fraser, the CMO of Zangotti, one of our latest sponsors. And welcome back, actually. You were a sponsor before. Zangotti has a performance management, capacity management tool that's very unique and interesting, and it has lots of uses. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it, and then we'll go and talk about our topics.
Sure. Zangotti has an infrastructure performance management solution. It's a virtual appliance. It actually drops in your hypervisor of choice across Zen Server from Citrix, vSphere from VMware, or Microsoft Hyper-V, in addition to other platforms we have in our roadmap. But those three today, you can pick your flavor of hypervisor, deploy us as a guest VM. We can monitor everything that's happening in vCenter. If you happen to have Hyper-V in your environment or Zen Server, we can manage those environments as well. We're unique in the marketplace in the sense that we start out by mapping your entire infrastructure, both your physical and your virtual components to your virtual infrastructure. We do the mapping, we establish the interdependencies, then we overlay that with what we call a storm tracker utility so that, you know, our real USP is getting to the root cause analysis of any potential degrading conditions you might have, contention storms, conflicts across all of the conventional silos, whether that's compute, storage, networking, of course. And we visualize that in a very nice high definition, high fidelity data stream that's live and continuous. In a very nice dashboard flavor, whether it's virtual infrastructure, VDI, virtual desktop infrastructure, web apps for e-commerce, and other kinds of use cases.
Well, basically, it's a network tool. It's a networking tool. You guys look at all the
networking. Well, networking is one piece that we do. That is our heritage. Our DNA is in networking. We started out. We've been around for about 8 years, 9 years. We started out as a network, physical network management appliance, looking at primarily the Cisco NetFlow estate or any flavor of NetFlow. But our founders, our CTO, who was one of the founders, is still with the company, sort of realized, you know, 2010, when virtualization really started to take off with vSphere gaining traction. Performance management is more than just the network piece. It's a very important piece. The network underlies everything. And I'm an ex-Cisco guy, so I'm a big network proponent. But then again, we are always the ones the fingers are being pointed at as well. So this idea of cross-silo intelligence and establishing the interdependencies between network, storage, IOPS, what we're seeing in the data stores from vCenter, for example, all the way down even to the end user in terms of health of the application that's being virtualized. So today we're much broader than the networking piece, and the user of our product is primarily the virtual infrastructure admin, if you will, who's managing the hypervisor, or the application admin who's delivering the virtualized business service.
Heritage in networking actually allows you to branch out into something that's really, really intriguing, and that's Internet of Things. Because that's
correct.
All network-based, you can actually discover it inside of an organization. So if you have the enterprise IoT, or if you
correct.
Are a consumer, you have the consumer IoT, or you're just a car company where the car is a part of it, you know, you can discover all that, which from the networking component, which is very, very nice. And then what do we do with it once we have all that information? I mean, is that imagine it's not part of today, but it definitely is something you could do today.
Correct. So call it, I like to call it smart luck. I think the there's a lot of people that use the terminology dumb luck, but I like to call it smart luck because we have some very, very smart people, PhDs, who stitch together this. It's an in-memory database architecture that doesn't require agents in order to collect the data. And one of those protocols on the networking side that Zangotti talks to, if you will, is IPFix. And that happens to be the same protocol that most of the things that will add unpredictive demand to your data center That's the protocol they're running. I think another big trend that we're going to see is adding APIs to those things. For example, you know, if you think of a connected car, and it's 25 gigs of data being sent somewhere every hour from one connected car. Now, that ends up in someone's database, perhaps, but it could also be in a shared infrastructure where it's draining resources that you don't even know about. So the cool thing that Zangati does is we're not only giving you that second-by-second live health status, and that's exactly what you see in our dashboard. We have the dynamic threshold concept. So if you start to cross into amber, we give you very prescriptive remedial actions to take. On the flip side, we're looking at saturation resources as well, because often you know, your degradation of performance has to do with either misallocation of memory or CPU, or bad, I mean, in some cases, not the right architecture. And we can spot that, and we can help you determine how to get more out of your resources. So if you've got a triage situation, we're good for that root cause analysis, because they're very, very granular. If you're on the other side, where you have a lot of data that's coming into the data center, and you're not sure how to predict how much bandwidth you might have, you might over-provision a lot of hardware just by guesswork, we actually going to give you very, very well-defined efficiency and capacity metrics to determine whether you might have three servers that are completely underutilized for the workload that you're virtualizing. We can tell you, in today's platform, we can actually automate the movement of those VMs to those underutilized resources as well.
When we think about it, when you start talking about IoT, you also can tell us if we don't have enough resources, which is really going to be
correct.
I think that's probably going to be the number one issue to start with when we start adding everything together that we have connected.
Well, I think there. You know, when you think of Internet of Things, first of all, there's a lot of data.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you think of a solar panel. I mean, there's 10,000 solar panels out there by, a manufacturer, and there's a lot of feedback coming off those panels in terms of their performance. So there's a lot of data you have to pull. There's an application that runs on top of that in order to know what to do with the data, right? That's the business logic. So you have to know about the health of that application as well. And then, hey, what about security? I mean, when we added the things to the whole connectivity and data center equation, we weren't necessarily thinking about, oh, and by the way, they need to be encrypted or they need to be secured. So Zangati actually looks at anomalies. And, you know, we have machine learning best practices capabilities. We're probing those assets that you have in your infrastructure to determine if we see something that, you know, after, say, 3 to 6 months, the machine learning kicks in, it looks a little strange, we give you an index in terms of anomalous traffic. So if someone's actually trying to, as we saw with the Chrysler Jeep, actually commandeer that through the connectivity, we're going to give you, you know, things like bit rate and, you know, extreme. We'll show you a graph of extreme bandwidth consumption for a particular area of your data center. The third one is the interactions. So the data and the application aren't running in isolation in terms of Internet of Things. They're also going to be interacting with everything else you're running in the data center. Zangati establishes those interdependencies. We're going to give you a lot of very granular detail in terms of where you might have conflicts, and actually predict for you 3 weeks from now where you might potentially have some degradation and what to do about it.
When with IoT, you're going to need that, because as you add more and more devices, you're going to saturate more and more, you know, wireless channels, or even more and more networking, or just even more your databases. If I was like producing a car, I mean, you're talking about cars, jet engines, I'm talking about controllers. These produce a huge amount of data. and knowing whether the other thing is should that data be even seen? If Zangotti's even seeing it, you may have a pro another problem. I may be able to detect you're on the network, but it shouldn't be data you can see. In some cases, that's where security comes in.
Well, then the other concept is smart, right? How do you get smart about the data?
Yep.
I mean, there's one thing to say, I've got this concept of Internet of Things because, my things happen to have the capability of connecting to the internet or to my data center or my hybrid cloud infrastructure. That's a lot of data in motion. That's a lot of data in rest. I have to worry about storage. I have to worry about security. But then, well, how do I analyze the data? What am I doing with the data?
That's
You know, so,
a whole another
the
topic.
analytics layer that Zangotti, if you think of a hierarchy of needs, we're at the top of that hierarchy because you're going to want to get very, very smart about how you're consuming the data. And Zangotti ingests, again, without the use of agents. You're not going to have to deploy software agents to everything. Nobody's going to want to do that.
No.
First of all, you get incredible productivity drain, increases the security risk because now I have to do patchwork on thousands of things. And those software agents are going to drain a lot of power. So our ability to be extensible in that sense, you drop these devices into your environment. It's one of the protocols that we already talked to, whether it's NetFlow, S-Flow, iFlow, IP fix from the networking standpoint, all of the popular storage topologies. So we're comparing the data from those protocols and whatever APIs that are available that we're picking up if it's in a virtualized environment from the hypervisor. We're crunching all that data in real time and giving you some kind of predictive sense of how to accommodate the demand of those things that are now being served by data and bandwidth.
And that's what we, I mean, that's where analytics comes in. If I'm going to log it all, I'm going to capture it all, I need to look at it. And if I'm not looking at it, in a lot of ways, we should just get rid of the data because
Right,
having too much data
exactly.
causes all sorts of problems.
Well, it's kind of like the too big to fail concept in a way, right? The more data you have, the more it becomes a target,
Yes.
for malicious activity. So
And
if
also
you're collecting,
the more
if you're,
tempting it is to
well,
do,
exactly.
and this is the one thing is if you don't know how you query the data today, you will not be able to query the data tomorrow. So if you're gathering a bunch of data that you think you'll be able to query tomorrow, it's a good chance you won't. Ask that first question you ask of the data, this sets the basis for how you will use the data in the future. You guys have your basis. Every tool does. And when you look at it, the first question you ask will dictate all those other types of analytics. Now, you can get as detailed as you want or as macro as you want, but that first question is going to kind of govern the rest of it. And that's why I would love what I'm thinking about with analytics is that it actually needs to be open in an organization. Let the users query the data that they want. You may find out some really interesting trends that you
Sure.
want to pay attention to.
Absolutely.
You know.
Yeah, what's interesting about, well, a couple of things. One is coming back to what you said is I sure would like to know that when I am doing the queries, I'm querying against good data.
Yes.
Because it's almost as important to know what not to ask or what kind of query not to ask as it is knowing the right query to ask. So collecting that data and then analyzing that data in terms of how people actually use it is something that we do today. But I think going forward, what I could imagine is a situation where you want to do long-term capacity planning. You want to compare your infrastructure from a point in time all the way through, let's say, a 3-year life cycle of your typical data center. The ability to actually suck in Zangotti's data through APIs is, I think, going to be a very, very powerful concept for us. So you can imagine if you run ServiceNow for your ITSM or even your event management, or you are a data scientist and you like the Splunk platform, now you can do a what-if risk analysis to infrastructure performance and infrastructure metrics and make that part of your risk equation, if you will. Everything from weather patterns to traffic patterns to physical locations to you know, geographic disparity. All of a sudden, the richness of that data becomes part of your business decision making, which is really about being more agile in a hybrid cloud kind of world that we're going to be living in.
Oh, I think we're already living in it, to be frank. When you look at the all the data that people can get, when you look at the fact that I now have Internet of Things, you look at all of that, having something that can give me an idea of what that data is doing for me is good. The business logic is important, but being able to query it is really, really important. So adding a RESTful API so I can query out the data and do whatever I want
right.
with it.
Exactly.
I can create a brand new basis. It makes my life a lot easier. And I think that's going to be the future. I really do. Because there's too much data from too many sources.
Right. So I think there's a concept here. So your audience is probably familiar with the Zengati dashboard. I mean, basically today, if you're running a virtual infrastructure, I mean, hundreds of thousands of interactions and data points we populate in that dashboard today. Where I see the future going is a micro dashboard, a micro service that says, you know, Edward is only interested in the certain amount of storage data that impacts a certain application in a certain part of the enterprise or across Docker containers and Azure clouds by the number of users and any other factor you want. And you're going to actually get that in a dynamic dashboard. That's how I think the power of the RESTful API capability that we're going to be bringing. You come back to the connected car and Internet of Things. Here's a crazy prediction for you, a wild card I'll throw out on the table. What if I start selling a car that includes a micro drone? Why wouldn't you want that? I live here in California. I know in Austin you have a little bit the more sane traffic patterns, but here in the Bay Area, I mean, you can roll the dice almost at any given moment, and you can be waylaid for a couple hours. You have traffic apps and those kinds of things, but why not if you know you're in a traffic jam? I have a micro drone. I just set the coordinates for that micro drone, check out the traffic, and then I can decide in a kind of a real world aspect what to do about that. I could use the micro drone for many, many other ethical purposes, keeping track of my children who are on Uber, monitoring my home when I'm away. So I think, again, if you think about the connected car, this is just the beginning, right?
Oh,
I
yes.
I mean, to be able to add, it's a platform, I'm going to add other services that are data-driven, that have applications, that drain performance, you know, on my data center. And so analytics, capturing the right data, making that data smart, and then right-sizing your infrastructure and your capacity to deliver the service.